on issues of Bihar migrants, elections, policies like Narega, Jivika, relevance of caste in elections. If I'm sure a lot of us have been following his writings in the recently concluded elections, where he's been, you know, he's used his prism to sort of talk about how these polls are different from the ones, from the last ones, and what does it hold for state and national politics. Professor Ashwani Kumar has also been a senior recipient of senior fellowship by ICSSR and Azim Premji University Research Grant. He's a widely published author and a very, very renowned poet. I welcome you, sir. Thank you so much for being with us today and enlightening us with your discussion today. We also have with us Professor Sanjay Kumar. I think every time on the eve of an election, as we all anticipate for trend projections and surveys, the one person who's got the figures right and the analysis absolutely in place in these very difficult times is Professor Sanjay Kumar. He's a professor at the Center for the Study of Developing Societies and has been the director of CSDS till January 2020. Professor Kumar very closely works on voting, election behavior, Indian youth, state of democracy in India. We have all seen him on television discussing polls and the pattern of voting in the most lucid terms possible for everybody to understand. It wouldn't be an exaggeration if I say that a lot of what I understand about electoral politics comes from Professor Sanjay Kumar. So, sir, thank you so much for being with us today. And we're really, really delighted to have you. And we're really excited to listen to your views on the elections. So today, the session is structured in a simple manner. I would request both of you to take 15 minutes approximately to lay out your views and your perspectives on the election. After this, we shall open the house for some questions. I'm sure a lot of us have a lot of burning questions to put to you. I request everybody to post your questions either on the chat box, or you could just raise your hands and you can ask your questions. After that, after Professor Kumar, Ashwani Kumar and Professor Sanjay Kumar have responded, we would take another set of questions. And finally, we would request both our speakers before the session ends today, to put their final thoughts. So before wasting more time, I would like to request Professor Ashwani Kumar to begin the session for today. Thank you so much.
Just a minor query to both the speakers. We have started recording. Is it fine with you, or should we stop it? So you are muted.
Fine with me. No problem.
No problem. I'm absolutely fine with the recording.
Okay. Yeah. Mr. Tony, please go ahead with the recording.
Asim, Professor Asim and Professor Khushbu, thank you very much for inviting us and inviting to this very significant and important election that just concluded in Bihar. I have a small request here before we begin the proceedings and I start talking about. I would love a more interactive, Sanjay is here, CSDS. Post-poll surveys out, and I'm sure that the students would love to hear more about, in terms of a detailed understanding of what has happened in Bihar. So I will start with Sanjay, if you agree with me, a short, not like a 15-minute monologous talk on what has happened and what is going to happen. That I want to propose. It should be more interactive, and more like in a format where we look at more significant aspects of elections in Bihar and beyond. I think that's far more important from my point of
view. My quick input to that would be, if you think that academicians are going to speak for 5-7 minutes, they will actually go on for 15 minutes. So just keep in mind that we are speaking for 7 minutes, 8 minutes, and we would end up completing our sentences in 15-16 minutes.
Let's see. I think.
So, shuru kijiye aap, fir main karu, and then I think we should try and leave as much time as possible for the students to ask questions.
Yeah.
Yehi hai bas.
That is the format I'm looking at. Asim,
yeah.
I don't want to give, there is little, the discussion is going on in the national media all over about Bihar. And I'm sure that the students are excited about, there are issues that we have not discussed in Bihar elections, you know, for instance, like policy aspect and other aspects. So what I would like to begin with, a very brief, kind of preface to the Bihar election. To my mind, you know, Bihar elections continue to be, and the verdict continues to be verdict extraordinary and historic. And there are reasons to believe what I'm going to, emphasize on is that what started out as a dull and project case of re-election of incumbent chief minister, Mr. Nitish Kumar, has certainly turned out to be a lesson that all of us are looking at very seriously and closely. Very few realized in the beginning, you know, just 45 days back, that the magic of development, seemed to have silently deserted Nitish Kumar, and the results are out. You know, he has been dented and diminished, not fully decimated. So he is still around and gonna be a chief minister once again, it seems like. And also, we have not looked at migrant crisis perhaps more closely. I have been looking at analysis, what has happened, with regard to the migrant and how migrant has voted in Bihar. So what looks like to me that, someone who is credited with Naya Bihar seems to have suffered most than others in the election, especially if I look at his partner like BJP. And in fact, BJP is a big gainer, I will talk about it later. But thus I'm setting the background. And very few would have imagined in their wildest dreams that Tejasvi Yadav would be a game changer, He failed to cross the line, but he continues to remain in the limelight, and potentially a big player in Bihar, whom I called, as a symbol of youth insurgency. Although it seems to me that verdict has not favored him decisively, and youth insurgency seems to have been halted on its tracks. But if you're looking at, Bihar elections closely, it seems that this is going to be a game changer election in future. The very dramatic rise of Tejasvi Yadav as the potential game changer in Bihar is a rare sort of generational event that attains landmark significance. Because I believe that, although it seems like, using cricket language and metaphor of IPL, it seems like a draw match, I don't think, I may be saying something that would provoke you to ask more and more questions about it. It doesn't seem like that BJP or NDA has won a very decisive match. It seems like, a draw match. It seems like perhaps I have been arguing in the last couple of weeks that this seems like a semi-final, and final would be played in 2025. So what I'm going to suggest here that the Bihar election 2020 opens up new possibilities of political alignments and ideological shifts in Bihar and perhaps beyond, even if it is not a template for fighting elections in other parts of the country, but certainly as a political scientist, I look at meaning perhaps in a micro sense too. So those who have been looking at Bihar from a past arithmetic, and they also need to consider Bihar elections perhaps a little more closely and perhaps a different lens. Because I'm looking at media reports and I'm also looking at various political analysts who have been covering Bihar, ignoring the reality of the left's standing success, and especially the success of Male. So I can see that, in the longer history of Bihar, where caste politics has been like a structuring, variable, but also class politics, Class politics has a long history in Bihar, and especially in the last 40, 50 years, since the beginning of the Naxal movements in the region called Flaming Fields, the success of left politics is also a very interesting, perhaps a turning point, not in just Bihar, but it might, spill over to to other parts of the country. And at least in these difficult times, when the right-wing politics is an ascendancy, not in just Bihar or perhaps in other parts of India and globally too, the very success of Male and this kind of a left unity, this kind of a coalitional politics where, you know, led by a very charismatic young leader, Tejaswi Yadav, I look at it is in terms of a generational, political, and demographic shift, you know. I was looking at, you know, candidates of, winning candidates of Male, most of them are very young, and they don't have the baggage of the past, you know, Naxal movement or, you know, other forms of the peasant movement or the mass mobilization movement in Bihar. And they are, you know, some of them are very, very adept at using new technology, using new language of politics, and certainly with a more, you know, more a kind of a new left politics. My sense is that it is certainly, I mean, like I'm looking at the longer history of Bihar through elections of 2020. It may not be, you know, an inqilab or a revolution, whether left revolution or right revolution, but it is certainly a momentous you know, election. It is certainly a momentous time, an event, at least in the contemporary history of Bihar. It might lead to reversal of you know, luck or fate of dominant political parties in Bihar, and especially if you look at you know, what I call feuding brothers, you know, or sibling rivalries in Bihar since the days of, you know, Tribeni Sangh movement. So from my point of view, the very rise of a young man, Tejaswi, whom I had called, you know, the prince of new generation of politics in Bihar, something that we need to, you know, come back and need to look at perhaps more closely. Also, you know, I'm looking at you know, the very rise of BJP. But here, in the context of Bihar, you know, my sense is that BJP has really been, you know, tamed by its own instinct and temperament, you know. And that's where I call that, you know, BJP has succeeded, certainly in this NDA formation, in establishing its position, you know, its dominant position, and also succeeded in reducing or diminishing the position of, you know, Sushasan Babu, you know, Nitish Kumar, who has certainly and indeed, you know, turned around Bihar from many, you know, as many of us have seen in the last 15 and 20 years. So BJP also in Bihar elections has not used, you know, its typical Hindutva logic and looked at Bihar perhaps as a lab, you know, as a lab where they can practice, and I have been talking about it in some of my recent works, that how Hindutva embraces a new form of welfare politics, a new form of Vikas politics, you know, although it's not that kind of, you know, inclusive politics, but certainly it's like Hindutva plus, you know. So if you look at the language of BJP in the elections and the post-elections, you know, after the results were announced, BJP hasn't used a very divisive language. In fact, BJP has been using the language of, you know, Sushasan Babu or Nitish Ji, you know, the language of Vikas, the language of governance, you know. And in fact, you know, BJP has been responding to Tejaswi Yadav's, you know, powerful agenda setting, you know, slogan of jobs, 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 you know. So here, if you look at Bihar, I think from my point of view, for BJP, you know, Bihar seems to be a very interesting lab, you know, a laboratory of testing new forms of Hindutva politics, you know, and new forms of, you know, also testing PM's popularity. Those who have been looking at elections right from the beginning, you know, they have noticed that somehow in Bihar, although there is now, you know, and BJP in the last, you know, in the second phase and the third phase, use the logic of, you know, return of the jungle raj, you know, return of the anarchy, or the very possibility of Bihar turning barbaric Bihar, you know. And this seems to have really impacted, at least, you know, from my point of view, and also looking at the data and the post-election analysis, second phase and third phase, I've been talking about it, that how it has impacted what we call upper caste counter-mobilization or consolidation in favor of not NDA, but at least in favor of BJP. So for BJP, changing its tack, changing its tracks, and, you know, responding to a new sort of ideological and political mobilizational tactic, I think Bihar will be a good lesson for them. And let's see how they are going to, you know, operate under the new change conditions of pandemic elections over time, shortly in West Bengal. And also, but what I'm looking at, and again, you know, in a more provocative sense, you know, I'm very happy that at least in this election in Bihar, we started, moving, not exactly we have transcended the caste sociology, but at least, or community sociology, but at least we are using in Bihar analysis, the new categories like gender and youth. So that's interesting for me. And those who are looking at a more policy-based analysis of election, I guess Bihar offers very interesting insights and surely a template. Because Bihar is the one place where, if you look at, and I've been talking about it for some time, that JDU is a very, very rare party. And this rare party in the sense that, it's led by a very charismatic socialist era, socialist era about whom I predicted that this is the last election. So I don't see the possibility of, socialist era leaders coming back again in 2025. So, but the fact is that, led by charismatic, but not mass leader, So JDU has never been, since the days of formation of Samata Party, has never been a, cadre-based mass political party. Always operated in the template of bureaucratic governance, but certainly changed the way we have looked at Bihar in the last 30 years. So if you look at the siblings, the feuding siblings, Laluji's logic, 92-2005, the social justice logic. I called it, a politics of, dream dope, giving dreams to people. And at the same time, giving poor people, especially, poor people, especially, and the underdogs and underprivileged in Bihar, a kind of liberatory potential. But he was never fond of, conventional state system. And in fact, he dislikes the old, Leviathan kind of, politics dominated by upper caste and upper class in Bihar. And cut to Nitish Kumar, certainly a credit must be given to him for, turning Bihar into, a different sort of land, a land of, huge potential, a land of, rising talent in the country, a land of 80 million youth population, and also, millions of migrant workers, and many of them, wanted, I've said elsewhere, they'll mangle more. So if you succeed, success, leads to its own, critiques and enemies. So to summarize what I said, that I would not speak more than 5 to 7 minutes. I guess Bihar, from this point of view, not just in terms of the numbers of what people got and which political party got how many seats, in the larger context of Bihar's politics, I'm thinking about Don Halton's phrase, Bihar is heart of India. I mean, although, the way Bihar has been kind of divided into two separate states, Jharkhand and Bihar, and that way perhaps Bihar is no longer the heart of India. Certainly Bihar has the potential to inform the politics, even if it doesn't become a template for national politics, but certainly Bihar can lead us into looking at Indian politics from different perspective, not only always from community perspective or caste sociology, but maybe from a new modern language of governance and development in this way. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Indeed, you flagged some really very relevant issues. Professor Sanjay Kumar, could I please request you to share your views with us?
Let me start with a lighter note. Ashwini ji, 7 minutes socha tha, 15 minutes aapne bola.
To main yahi
bilkul 16 minutes bola aapne. To main bhi man mein 7 minutes ka hi sochunga to 15 minutes bolunga. 15 minutes socha to aadha ghanta ho jayega.
Nahi Sanjay ji, but Sanjay ji, this is I must confess, you know, Asim and Kus, but this is like Zoom effect, you know. I really want to
nahi lekin kaam ki baat hui. चलिए मैं अब अपनी पारी दूसरे एंड से बैटिंग की कोशिश करता हूं कुछ सी आई वुड ट्राई एंड पिक अप सम इश्यूज एंड देन रिस्पोंड टू दोज इश्यूज एंड आई एम गोइंग टू पिक अप दोज इश्यूज व्हिच आर बीइंग डिबेटेड व्हाट हैपेंड इन दिस इलेक्शन रिगार्डिंग दोज इश्यूज सो लेट मी पिक अप द फर्स्ट इशू व्हिच इज वाज देयर एनी एंटी इनकमिंग हाउ डू वी रीड द वर्डिक्ट Because reading this verdict had become very difficult. And why do I say that it has become very difficult? Because both the alliances are tied up at exactly similar number of votes. 37.3% for NDA and 37.2% for Mahagathbandhan. And doing an analysis of this kind of a verdict becomes very difficult because you have to look for plus points in both the alliances, you also have to look for the minus. And it's very difficult if you want to be seen as a neutral observer, because if you start saying something positive about one alliance, then you are seen as taking sides because there is hardly any difference in the support base of two political alliances. So this whole question of, is this a vote for Nitish Kumar, for the re-election of Nitish Kumar, do we see this vote as an anti-incumbency vote, Nitish Hatao vote? How do we read this mandate? I am very clear about that. I don't know whether I am able to convince my viewer and listener. That's a different story. I am convinced this is an anti-Nitish vote. Anti-incumbency was very strong against Nitish Kumar, not against NDA government as such. There was no anti-incumbency against BJP. So clearly, I see this verdict as an anti-incumbency against Nitish Kumar, a sign for change. There are various threads of change which I saw visible in the electoral verdict. While those signs of change could not actually got full blown, there was a wind of change blowing, but that wind could not become a storm. And if it had become a storm, the government would have definitely lost badly. The question which is being also asked is, if there was an anti-incumbency against Nitish Kumar, why did we not see any anti-incumbency against BJP? Why BJP managed to do well? These two have been in alliance, these two have been in government in Bihar. So if the anti-incumbency was against Nitish Kumar, there would have been some impact on Modi as well. My response to that question is, even though both the parties have been in government together, Bihar had a coalition government, but the government was known in the name of Nitish Babu ki Sarkar, not even JDU. And people, if you talk to the people, you would know that how Nitish Kumar was in full command running the government. So BJP was in alliance. BJP was in alliance with the government, but people saw it as a Nitish Kumar government. So when there were applauses for Nitish Kumar's work, and that was Nitish Kumar was rewarded by a big victory in 2010, it was all Nitish Kumar, Nitish Kumar, Nitish Kumar's success. And now when people were being critical, so they were critical about Nitish Kumar, not about BJP. So people's anger did not get directed towards BJP. And I would also like to connect here the fact, Modi factor. Prime Minister Modi's campaign actually helped BJP in consolidating its vote share, or I can say at least in maintaining their support base. If Modi had not campaigned, maybe Nitish Kumar's unpopularity would have affected BJP to some extent, but Modi's campaign helped in saving BJP, BJP's support base. He kept the BJP support base intact, and I see a large number of people in Bihar looking forward, looking to BJP as the party of the future. Even though they have been voting for Nitish Kumar and BJP in the past, but many of them have been voting for Nitish Kumar reluctantly, being BJP supporters because of the alliance factor. Now, large number of these people are looking forward to BJP. They are very thrilled about BJP emerging as a large party. And now they want to see BJP as in full command in Bihar. So because of these kinds of feeling among the voters and this distinction they made between Nitish Kumar and Modi and JDU and BJP, so this the declining popularity of Nitish Kumar did not hurt BJP, while it hurt JDU. What also hurt JDU was Chirag Paswan contesting against Nitish Kumar. I don't want to go into those details, but clearly there are visible evidence of Chirag Paswan hurting Nitish Kumar. So that's point number one, on which I have my take, that this verdict gives us a sign of change. There was a strong signal of change. There was a anti-incumbency mood against Nitish Kumar, even though they have got re-elected. They will be in power for 5 years. But I don't see this as an endorsement for the work done by Nitish Kumar during last 5 years. Second point, and on this, I have a very different take from what Professor Ashwini Kumar mentioned. This is about, do we see vote caste-based politics, if not disappearing in Bihar, but at least weakening? Does the verdict gives us any indication of caste-based voting in Bihar weakening, if not disappearing? I don't see any evidence of that. When we saw lots of young voters rallying behind Tejaswi Yadav, that had given me hope. That had given many others hope that this time, at least the young voters are not going to vote on caste line, because these young voters who are rallying behind Tejaswi Yadav do not come from one caste community. We see that these young voters are coming from across caste community. So if these young voters unite as young voters, and vote as young voters in favor of Tejaswi, which was the sign during the campaign, and they did vote for Tejaswi Yadav in sizable numbers. So I had the hope that, you know, we would see a different pattern emerging. We would see young emerging as a political category in Bihar. So first, on the caste-based politics in Bihar, caste-based voting in Bihar. No sign of weakening, even weakening of caste-based voting in Bihar. Why do I say that? Look at the votes polled by different political parties, which is exactly the vote of their core supporters. No political party managed to surge and reach 100 seats or surge far ahead compared to their traditional support base. It was only because they were unable to make inroads among caste communities other than their own core supporters. I will give you a few figures to give you an indication, to give you an idea how this election witnessed caste polarization even much sharper compared to any elections held in this state for the last 30 years. The Yadavs voting for RJD Gathbandhan, more than 80%. Never in the past. Kurmis voting for Nitish Kumar, more than 80%, never in the past. The highest polarization of these two communities for their own respective leaders. I'm not saying these are only the leaders of their own caste, but this is how people see them. This is at least how people of their own, of these communities, see these two leaders. Earlier, Lalu Yadav, and now Tejaswi Yadav, and Nitish Kumar on the other side. Earlier, the polarization of the two castes for their own leader or for their own party used to be highest at about, say, 72-73%. This election has breached that ceiling and it has reached 80%. Even Muslims have voted for Gathbandhan in much bigger numbers now, in this election. Though in those five constituency, AIMIM did make a strong presence. They managed to win five seats because they dented the Muslim vote in those constituency. But if you leave as those constituencies, five or six constituency, besides that, AIMIM was unable to get sizable number of votes, sizable number of Muslim votes. So Muslim polarization for Gathbandhan is also 75%, which is also one of the highest. Upper caste polarization, not to that extent. But yes, they remain polarized in favor of BJP and NDA Gathbandhan. What we see is the fragmentation of Dalit vote. We cannot see in this election Dalit vote as one vote. We have to see Dalits in terms of Paswans, Ravidas, and other Dalits. And if you look at the voting pattern, the voters of these three Dalit communities have remained divided. So what the Dalits vote have got fragmented. Lower OBCs have remained largely united behind Nitish Kumar and BJP Gathbandhan. So on this question of do we see caste-based voting weakening in Bihar, I don't even want to put a question mark. I would say no. This election has, in this election, we have signs of caste-based politics getting reinforced. Reinforced in a much, much stronger way compared to the past elections. Young voters, lots of talk about young voters, that young voters are going to vote for Tejaswi Yadav in a very large numbers. We do get signals of young voters voting in favor of Tejaswi Yadav, but there is a catch. If there was no gender divide between these young voters, I think Gathbandhan would have registered a victory. What happened is that even among the young voters, there is a gender divide even among the young voters in the age group of 18 to 22, 23, 24. The male young voters voted in favor of Mahagathbandhan in large numbers. Women young voters, the young girls, voted in favor of Nitish Kumar and BJP in much bigger numbers. And when I say bigger numbers, the difference between men and young women and young men for a particular alliance is in the range of 5 to 6%, which is good enough a difference to statistically significant, good enough a number to give you leading edge. So if the young voters would have voted on one side, they could have made a bigger difference for Gathbandhan. But within the young voters, we see this gender divide. So this connects to the issue of besides the young voters, voted for Nitish Kumar in sizable number, which actually helped NDA in consolidating their support base. Even in the 2000, I think there has been an overstatement about women voting for Nitish Kumar in a very large numbers. Women have turned out in very large numbers. 2010, 2015 election, in 2015 election, 7% more women turned out compared to men. Even in these elections, women have turned out in much bigger numbers compared to men. But the advantage Nitish Kumar and NDA has among the women voters is just 2.5-3%, not more than that. It's not an advantage of 10%. Imagine if it is an advantage of 10%, and when women are turning out to vote in such a large number, it could result in a landslide victory for NDA. So women, yes, there is an advantage for NDA among women vote, which was visible in earlier election. It is still visible to some extent in this election, but not to the extent as we tend to believe. We tend to believe, or some people tend to believe, that women mein toh 8-10% jyada Nitish ko vote kiya. If that's the case, it would give them a landslide victory. And the reason are women are in equal number as men are in the electoral roll, but what can go to the huge advantage of Nitish Kumar and NDA is their higher turnout. They are turning out to vote in much bigger numbers. So even a small difference, even a small advantage, results in a sizable number of votes for Nitish Kumar, and that seems to have happened. And the last point, Because I am looking at the watch, I have already completed my 14 minutes. Last point. Was this a routine election like the earlier election, or do we see anything new in this election? No. This election, I don't consider it as a routine election. There were things which needs to be noticed, which needs to be mentioned. And that is the issue in this election. Many elections are issueless, very local issues dominate. Sometimes, the issues are not dominant, and then the caste-based voting, etc., etc. Those are the issues which dominate Bihar election. This was the election where unemployment was foregrounded. It was the issue of election. Whether Mahagathbandhan managed to win election or not, they have not been able to win election. They have not been able to cross that magic figure. But they fought the election on an issue which concerned the common man, which is the issue of unemployment. And the issue of unemployment was so much grounded in these elections that a big party like BJP and in alliance with NDA, they were unable to set their own agenda. They had to respond to this. And how they responded? If Tejasvi Yadav is promising 10 lakh jobs for the youth, they responded by saying 19 lakh job opportunities, employment opportunities. So employment, job, rozgar came at the center of this election. This issue comes up in most of the election, whether it is Bihar or Maharashtra or Tamil Nadu. Unemployment as an issue comes up in every election, but not as strongly as we have seen in this election. Certainly not as strongly as we have seen in this election. We have not seen this kind of a strong resonance of this issue among the voters. If I compare it with the past elections in Bihar. So that's new about Bihar election, this election. Also, Tejasvi may not have been able to win this election, but I think he has set, he has set the template of a campaign. And what is the template? You know, a positive campaign can do wonders. He never got engaged in this tutu meme. Because he was attacked personally, his family was attacked, 15 years of jungle of RJD rule was attacked as Jungle Raj, but he never responded to that. He refrained from responding to those questions. He kept his focus on the issue of development, on the issue of employment, kept promising. Whether those promises were fake or not, we don't know. And now there is no way to test because he's not going to be in the chief minister's chair. But he kept his focus, he kept his cool, he kept the issue of unemployment at the center. And this positive campaign actually, I think, did wonders for Mahagathbandhan. And why I say use this word wonders? Because look at the vote estimate. It is neck to neck in Bihar. This may not have been possible. I also believe that 3 months back, I used to say, Bihar mein chunao hai nahi hai. If people used to ask, Bihar mein kya hoga? I used to say, Bihar mein chunao kahan? It's a landslide victory for NDA. The credit which goes to Tejasvi is to make this election an election and make it a photo finish. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I would request you to ask your questions. So there is a question from one of our students, which is, why did young voters vote for the NDA and not for the Mahagathbandhan?
Khushbu, she's a professor at TISS Mumbai.
So sorry, sir.
My response to that is, as I said, there is a gender divide we have seen in voting in favor of Nitish Kumar. And that is because of the several welfare policies which Nitish Kumar had initiated when he has been the chief minister. And between 2005 and 10, after 2010, and even, you know, Nasha Bandi since he became the chief minister in his latest term. So I said that there is a gender divide even among the young voters. So the women among the young voters voted in favor of Nitish Kumar because of the welfare policies, because they thought that this is the man who has done something for us, for the welfare of women. And maybe they thought that we should be supporting Nitish Kumar and not Tejasvi Yadav.
Thank you, sir. Ashwani, sir, there is a question for you. It's on the chat box, if I can read it for you. It's from one of your students who says that when you discuss the idea of India, you would always end the discussion with the song Mele Sur Mera Tumhara. But the way in which the world's largest democracy is working does not go well with that visionary song. So how do you see that? Sir, you are on mute, sir. I think you'll have to unmute yourself.
I'm really touched by affections of my students and listeners who have followed my, you know, my classes and my thoughts about idea of India. In fact, I'm working on idea of Bihar as well. So certainly I will reflect a little bit on idea of Bihar as well. But then let me say, Mile Sur Mera Tumhara, you know, those who have asked the question, I think, you know, when I was, you know, on the channel at Mojo with Barka, a whole day, you know, tracking the results, reflecting on results. And in the middle of night, when it became clear that, you know, it's going to be a photo finish, you know, I was thinking about, you know, how I'm going to interpret the results, not just analyze the results. I'm making a subtle, conceptual distinction between interpretive idea of politics and empirical idea of politics. So, mujhe ye laga ki, you know, what I was thinking, and I was tired and fatigued, you know. And even then, I thought about, I will share with someone who has asked this question. Sawal neend ka hota, sawal neend ka hota, Rahat Indwari ke style mein. सवाल नींद का होता तो कोई बात न थी सवाल असीम भाई ध्यान देंगे सवाल नींद का होता तो कोई बात न थी हमारे सामने खावों का भी तो मसला था तो मेरे लिए यू नो व्हेन आई लुक एट यू नो बिहार आई थिंक आई लुक एट बिहार वेरी डिफरेंटली आई लुक एट बिहार नॉट एम्पिरिकली आई लुक एट बिहार हिस्टोरिकली एंड इंटरप्रेटिवली ऑल्सो सो बिहार यू नो बिहार इज अ लैंड You know, land of, you know, equity, land of inclusiveness. You know. Somehow, you know, if you look at, you know, and Bihar also became barbaric, you know. And let me tell you, if you look at my book, you know, where I have referred, the word Jangal Raj was first time used, I think, by Gandhiji himself in Bihar, in reference to the private army and private sena of Jamindars. So it's not the first time that the Jangal Raj acquired a larger meaning. Because Jangal Raj, Gandhiji used in the context of, you know, suppression of the rights of, you know, peasants, you know, in the context of Jamindari. So I think, you know, this election, you know, and this is where I'm looking at, you know, one kind of politics, which is not inclusive politics, you know. It is a majoritarian politics, you know. So I'm really worried about two conflicting ideas of perhaps Bihar and in the larger context of India. So Bihar elections and results of elections are very significant, you know. Where Bihar would be in 2025 or maybe 2030, you know, how would Bihar inform the politics of India? I guess, you know, it seems like, you know, with diminished Nitish Kumar and almost, you know, gone, you know, and Nitish Kumar, you know, give the credit where it is due to him, you know. And once, you know, he's out of the frame, you know, currently he's in the frame, and you can see, you know, in the historical sense, you know, three brothers, you know, Triveni Sangh brothers, you know, I love to use Triveni Sangh metaphor, you know, again and again, because Bihar is largely formed in the last 75 years by Triveni Sangh landscape, the political landscape. So what would happen that, you know, is a conjecture at this juncture, but seems like Khusbu and Asim and Sanjay ji also, I would like to hear his response, that there seems to be a, you know, a politics of majoritarian politics, you know, what seems like NDA politics. On the other hand, you know, if Tejasvi had succeeded, you know, and succeeded what he called, you know, caste plus politics, you know, jobs, 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 you know. This is where I'm coming into and suggesting that, you know, caste is operating in Bihar perhaps in a very different form, you know. It's not the conventional caste politics or community politics. We all know that caste is a building block of Indian society. We can't dismiss it. But, you know, look at, you know, I'm emphasizing again and again that these victories, you know, victories of smaller political parties are very meaningful, you know, because they indicate that there is an alternative idea of Bihar, perhaps, you know, more inclusive, more equitable idea, and, you know, the idea which is, you know, pregnant with potentially a more post-clientelistic Bihar, you know, rather than a caste-based patronist politics. At least I can hear, I can see echoes of that politics in this, what I call a draw match in me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Draw match mat boliye, boliye nail biting finish.
Wo bhi hai, nail biting finish.
Lekin chaliye apne apna apna soch hai, aap usko draw match boliye, main to nail biting finish hi bolunga.
You know, Sanjay ji, mera draw isliye keh raha hoon na ki I'm looking at two kinds of politics, you know. So there is a one majoritarian kind of politics. And all said and done, Sanjay ji, we have been working on Bihar last 30 years, you know. In fact, you know, at some place I compared, you know, this job Asim is not a new thing, you know. I was a young kid, you know, and, you know, holding the hand of my father and going to Gandhi Maidan and witnessed the great man Jayaprakash Narayan and heard first time, Sihasan Khali Karo Janta Aati. Jobs, jobs, jobs. Indira Gandhi was dictator, but at the same time, price rise, job. So I can see that there is a connection. You know, without history, I can't explain politics. So that you know, when I look at HSP and the way he conducted himself and revived that memory is brilliant stuff, you know. And this is where interpretive politics is so important to us, you know. So let us look at Bihar in the larger context of Bihar itself, before we look at India. That's my suggestion, Sanjay ji. Isliye maine draw kaha, because it's at, you know, this is where I'm looking at, you know, again and again, that is it really a semi-final? Or what can be, you know, final in Bihar, you know, in the state politics, not in the national politics. Looking at, you know, that will, you know, what will happen, you know, to JDU after this is gone? Will BJP become, you know, I'm using this, you know, idea of Rajni Kothari, dominant political party? It's not system dominating political party, at least in the regional context, you know. Or will Bihar become replicate like Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh or Chhattisgarh, you know? What would Bihar look like potentially in 2025 or 2030? So this Bihar has certainly changed, you know. For me, this is transformatory election in the larger sense, you know. Metaphorical sense also, and substantive sense, that Biharis will use more and more, you know, developmental language, you know, even if they are voting on community. That's done deal in Bihar. Bihar is not going to go back, you know, 40 years back of Jagannath Misra brand of politics, you know. That's not going to happen, you know. That's over forever.
So Bhavish, you have a question, please go ahead if you want to ask.
My question is to Ashwani, sir. Sir, can am I audible?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Sir, if the conceptualization of Mahagathbandhan is in popular appeal, so do you think that political scientists has to pay more attention to the manifestations of this kind of pre-poll coalitions in ground also? Because I think the political scientists are not reading well the conception of whole Mahagathbandhan as such. I want your views.
I lost your question halfway. Prasbu, can you repeat the question?
Bhavish, do you want to go?
Yes. Yeah. Khushbu, can you take a couple of questions together before, okay. So, because we don't have much time. So.
Okay. Okay. Sir, so, there's another question that talks about, you know, about women voters voting for the NDA. So, what do you think is the role or impact of schemes like Ujwala Yojana or Sukanya Samriddhi Yojana? What role have they played in shifting of votes with regards to women?
Sanjay ji, I'm happy if Sanjay ji responds to this question. Because Sanjay ji, I'm asking you, you know, a personal question. I haven't looked at your survey questions. So I was thinking that, you know, when Asutosh Basna and you were collaborating on you know, between election study, and we were talking about, you know, policy issues, I guess, you know. So I would like to see your response. I would come back.
Quick response on this question. Yes, several factors has contributed to women having a soft corner or shifting their vote or tilting their vote in favor of Nitish Kumar and NDA. And the schemes which you mentioned are one of those factors.
Yeah. And my reply to the question, you know, how do political scientists look at Mahagathbandhan? I'm sure that political scientists are paying a lot of attention to Mahagathbandhan, you know, and this is where I'm looking at Mahagathbandhan, you know, a little problematic term if you are a Bihari, because Maha means, you know, you are very powerful, you know. But then you have to really deconstruct the term. I hope those who are postmodernist here amongst us, they would look at, you know, if you are in a Bihar village and if you're really a Maha, you know, like powerful, it conveys the idea of, you know, really, you know, feudal society and powerful society. So I'm dismissing that and deconstructing it. Mahagathbandhan, I'm juxtaposing with, you know, majoritarian politics. I think if you look at, you know, politics of subalternity, or politics of, you know, Bahujan, politics of Bahujan, and to me, you know, Tejasvi is a future, you know, in the sense of, you know, giving meaning to a new kind of Bahujan politics, you know, not the old conventional Bahujan politics in terms of community politics, but in terms of a new idea of politics, you know. That is the historic responsibility for Tejasvi, I think. To define and redefine, you know, vis-a-vis majoritarian politics.
Sanjay, sir, if I can ask you, what role do you think Congress will play in unifying the forces of opposition? And also, what does Bihar election mean for elections in West Bengal and Tamil Nadu?
And Congress, Ashwini ji, is better suited to respond.
Sanjay ji, yes.
ये रिकॉर्डिंग नहीं हुआ ये वाला
अच्छा अच्छा नहीं हुआ संजय जी I would be very frank today, Sanjay ji, very frank, and you know, with friends like Sanjay ji and Asim and all of you, I called, you know, I went on record that in Bihar, you know, Congress party is mostly like a virtual political party. It's not a real political party. And that doesn't mean that I'm kind of discounting the national politics of Congress, but certainly Sanjay ji is far more qualified than me to speak on that, you know, what we call, you know, federalization of Congress, you know, because he and Yogendra Yadav ji have been looking at federalization and the shrinking social base of Congress over time. But certainly Congress in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and other places where the two-party systems operate, you know, bimodal quality, you know, it's quite a significant player, but not in Bihar. You know. And you know, the biggest tactical mistake that Tejasvi did, and I'm on record, he should have really given Congress not more than, you know, 50 seats. This was a real blunder, you know, and this match would not have looked like this, you know, a photo finish or a draw match. Tejasvi would have really won the day. So Congress, I guess, and I can really predict, I don't want to predict anything. I more like to see myself as an analyst. Congress has, you know, no future in Bihar other than, you know, because you see that once BJP acquires a little more space in Bihar, you know, with upper caste counter mobilization, Congress will lose its rest of relevancy. Sanjay ji.
And what are your projections based, you know?
No, I would like to hear Sanjay ji.
There were two sharp questions in that. One was, how do I see Congress' role in uniting the opposition nationally? They have failed in doing that in 2014. They have failed in uniting the opposition in 2019. At the moment, there is no sign of Congress being able to unite the opposition nationally. And this is largely because of the issue of leadership. While Congress would like to keep the leadership if they want to unite the opposition, the difficulty with various leaders of the opposition party, the regional parties, that they are not ready to accept Rahul Gandhi as their leader. So this issue of leadership is going to be a big hurdle for Congress making any effort to unite large number of regional parties as a national alternative. And the second question is, what kind of a role do I see of Congress in elections which are due in West Bengal? Let's not even discuss that and waste time on that. Let's go for other questions. It's like waste of time discussing Congress in West Bengal in the next election.
Sanjay can go first. He's raised his hands quite early. I'm not able to raise my hand. Some problem with my laptop.
Yes,
Sanjay, sir. Can you go ahead first?
Yeah. May I? Yes, sir. So I would like to ask Sanjay, sir. So like in Punjab, the NDA has deserted Akali Dal. So here also in Bihar, was there some kind of an underhanded strategy? Because they try to undermine Nitish Kumar in this election. So LJP and JDU, what happened there? Could you elaborate on that, sir?
Elaborate on what?
So like, is there some kind of an underhanded strategy by BJP to undermine JDU, to undermine Nitish Kumar in Bihar?
See, my research won't give me any evidence for that. But if we go by whatever we have been listening, hearing, understanding, there was an obvious strategy of BJP to undercut Nitish Kumar. They never wanted to lose elections. They have not lost election. They managed to finally win election NDA. But they wanted to, you know, keep Nitish Kumar's size at a lower level. And that, I think that is what they have been able to do. So something fishy went around in Bihar election to keep Nitish Kumar to his size.
Amit, do you want to go?
Yeah, thank you. This is Amit Sadukan. So my question is to both of these panelists, saying that when you are saying that people in Bihar actually voted for whatever parties based on their claims on the job creation that they are going to do. As an incumbent government, Nitish Kumar's government, what is it that even the NDA at the center, why is it not that people are actually voting based on the kind of experience they have probably throughout this pandemic and the kind of sufferings? I'm trying to connect it with the sense that Bihar is the one of the major states, actually the highest number of migrants that goes out from Bihar to other states, okay? And therefore, this is the one state which has probably suffered most out of this pandemic related to the migrant-related crisis, and you can say. Now, why is it that some reflections are not there in terms of how the, you know, incumbent government and the government at the center manage the situation rather than hoping for something 19 lakh job or 10 lakh, which is very important. Jobs are very important. But somehow for the incumbent government, the electorate should reflect on the experience they have rather than expectation they have on the government they are choosing. So where is that mismatch? Why is it not that they are taking into experience into account when they are electing their government rather than the expectation from the government? Can you just reflect it with in the case that both of the panelists were mentioning that employment was a big kind of promise that can be good one? Thank you. Thank you so much.
So on migration, Ashwini ji has to speak first.
Sanjay ji, my worry is following you, Sanjay ji. I've been following. Yeah, Sanjay ji, in fact, you know,
I can respond quickly and then you can.
Please.
Come in. See, the whole issue of migrants, what are the number of migrants? This whole, the idea that migrants are going to play a very important role in Bihar election was far, far, far overstated. And why do I say that? Look at the numbers. the migrants who returned back to Bihar were, say, about 30 lakh, 40 lakh, 50 lakh, at the most, 35, 40 lakhs. Number size of electorates in Bihar, 7 crores. How many voted? 4.25 crores. What is the proportion of 30 lakh, 40 lakh, 50 lakh migrants out of the total number of voters? They don't even constitute 0.001% of the total voters. That's one. In terms of numbers, they don't matter in Bihar elections. Second, of these 40 or 50 lakhs migrants who came back, many of them actually returned back to cities. So, third point, many of the migrants who actually came and who were still there in the villages at the time of elections were not the voters of Bihar. They had already registered themselves in the city where they are living. So there was an overstatement that these migrants are going to, you know, put the Nitish Kumar government in difficulty. But what they have been able to do, because they have remained unemployed, berojgar, and there has been lots of livelihood issues when they returned back, they and their families. So this sense of growing unemployment, growing difficulties among the common people, that started growing, and this is what Tejaswi Yadav was able to capitalize. So all the difficulties which the migrants face at the time of COVID when they returned back was all packed into, I would say, teen char cheezon ko, that was packed into one word, which is unemployment, berojgari, rojgar ki samasya. And this is what actually worked in this election. So migrant issue contributed to this whole issue which Tejaswi Yadav was able to generate around unemployment.
More or less, you know, I agree with Sanjayji, and in fact there is a larger methodological issue here. I mean, like, whenever we work at migrant, you know, and especially reverse migration, so of late when we have started looking at tracking and the numbers and the patterns of reverse migration, it was very difficult to arrive at a very reasonable assessment of, you know, migrants. Certainly, you know, but what has happened in Bihar, interestingly, that migrant, you know, the whole question of suffering migrant really, you know, contributed to what I call political imaginary of Bihar. So for times to come, let us not dismiss migrant, you know, simply by referring to the numbers, you know, how many of them are there, how they are going to, you know, exercise their preferences in elections. But as Sanjay rightly pointed out, that the plight of the migrant has been captured largely in terms of the imaginary of employment and jobs. That's true. But at the same time, I don't recall any elections, you know, at least in 30 years, where the migrant, you know, and Sanjay, you know, tracking the data, he could enlighten us, that I've never ever seen migrant, you know, coming onto the fore of elections. That has happened in this election. So those working on migrant, for them, it's a big news, you know, because we have never looked at, you know, migrant from political or electoral perspective. We are looking at migrant largely, you know, policy perspective. So this is here Bihar elections are important, you know. And secondly, I would, you know, suggest here that if you recall speeches of Prime Minister, you know, Mr. Modi, I think he was also responding, you know, sometimes directly and sometimes, you know, indirectly, that, you know, here is aspirational Bihari. And no Bihari likes the tag, you know, and especially if you are a poor Bihari or a poor working migrant Bihari, you don't like the tag of, you know, suffering elsewhere. You know, I live in Mumbai, you know, we are called Bhaiya. You know, we don't like the tag. I think there is some element of, you know, a building of a new Bihari identity, I guess, you know, what I call aspirational Bihari. And this is where I, you know, put together both, you know, Modi, PM Modi, and also Tejaswi. You know, both spoke almost identical language of aspirational Bihari. I'm looking at, you know, a superstructure of politics, not the structure of politics. Thank you.
Yes, Asim sir.
Thank you, Khushbu. Thank you so much to both the speakers. I just want to put a larger question for your consideration. See, what is happening is a re-engineering of a new party system. This is, I'll just explain what, and then want your comments on that. See, what in Bihar effectively NDA has achieved, the so-called NDA, that is disseminated two of its important coalition partners. Similarly, and this is not a Bihar specific thing. If you go state after state, is some kind of what Ashwani ji earlier referred to, one party dominant system. So the BJP is gradually evolving towards that. So how to what extent this engineering of the party system will have implication on national politics?
Ashwani ji, aap karenge ab?
Aap shuru kare na aap.
See, my own sense is that slowly and gradually, in whichever state BJP has been in alliance with regional party, you're right that they are trying to first, if BJP has been a junior partner to a dominant regional partner, they wait for some time, they try and make inroads slowly and gradually. They try and capitalize on the popularity of the regional party, and the effort is to minimize the impact of the regional party. I think in the national politics, what we have seen during last, its implication on the national politics, last 5-7 years, there is a 6-7 years, there is a clear signal of BJP emerging stronger and stronger. No challenge to BJP nationally, because nationally, it's only Congress which can pose the challenge. Congress has been very weak in the states where BJP is up against. And why this is the strategy of BJP? I think because BJP realizes that wherever BJP is in contest with Congress, it is much easier for BJP to dominate over Congress. And they can see what is happening in, say, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Himachal, Uttarakhand, all the Hindi Bhashi states. Where Congress is the only dominant player, in a sense, Congress and BJP, there's a bipolar contest. So they have been able to dominate over Congress in a very emphatic, in a very massive manner. But the BJP is only facing the difficulty in its expansion in the states where regional parties are very strong. And we can keep taking names of all the states, say in the Eastern Belt, whether it's Telangana, Andhra, Bengal, Odisha, going downwards to say Tamil Nadu, Kerala. So all these are the states where regional parties are very strong, even Punjab, and that is why they have not been able to expand. So if the strategy remains that we have to cut the regional party to size, it is going to allow BJP a much bigger space to play in the national politics. They will expand their footprints in southern states and in those states where they have not been popular. And Congress needs to really work hard to emerge as a national alternative. Otherwise, what we used to see witness in the 70s and 80s, one party dominant system, that has already emerged. But there is no challenger to one party dominant system. In the coming years, I don't see BJP even facing a challenge for that.
And Asim, I think, you know, I've referred last year, you know, largely circulated piece where I mentioned that BJP is spreading in every nook and corner. So my sense is that, you know, Sanjay is absolutely right, you know, based on his analysis of 30, 40 years of party system in India. But there is a catch here, you know. Maybe there is slight difference that I would suggest, you know. Because in the Kotharian scheme, Congress expanded and became a system dominant party through, you know, rainbow kind of arrangement. And if you look at works of, you know, political scientists, leading political scientists, I think we looked at Congress more as, you know, kind of a decentralized, you know, way Congress expanded and reached into the pores of politics in India. But compared to Congress, you know, rainbow arrangement or rainbow polity, BJP by temperament and instinct is a centralized political party. And secondly, BJP is a cadre-based political party, which is a structural difference between Kotharian idea of Congress as a system-dominant party and BJP as a system-dominant party. It's a cadre-based political party, and it doesn't like decentralization or federalization of the party system. So therefore, the future looks like, weakening of power sharing polity in India or consociational polity in India. So that's a big challenge, you know. So as a political scientist, we need to really look at this possibility that if BJP, given what kind of, centralized majoritarian politics, this is again another structural, distinction between inclusiveness of Congress and majoritarian instinct of the BJP party. So my sense is that, BJP would resist federalization in the party system and would like to emerge as a centralized political party.
Thank you, sir. There is another question, and there is this growing, debate that is going on with regards to the left winning, the left doing well in the elections in Bihar on the one hand, and Owaisi coming to, getting seats on the other hand. How do you look at that? What do you think, what is that, its significance for politics at large?
Sorry, what was the second question? Owaisi's?
Owaisi and the left doing well in Bihar polls. So what do you think is that the significance?
Both class-based and religious-based parties are doing good. So what is the significance? Why is there an export from Bihar?
No, with regard to the left parties, I don't know. I said in the morning in some other discussion, I don't see any sign of these victories of the left does not give me any signal that left would be able to expand in other parts of Bihar. Leave aside me getting any signal that left is going to expand in other parts of the country. They managed to win because of the alliance with RJD and Congress. There was good vote transfer, but I am not taking away the credit from them. They have been working hard in the constituencies where they contested. Ashwini ji has already mentioned that they had put up young candidates, which I had not looked at carefully. So I think the candidate, their work in those constituencies, contesting a smaller number of constituencies, keeping the focus there, that has helped the left parties in winning those seats. But I would again repeat, I don't see any national implication of this victory of the left on the national politics. AIMIM winning 5 seats, I think they would look forward to their expansion in other parts of the country where there is sizable number of Muslim population, and they would have got the message that at least the message they would get from this verdict is that in the states where Congress is not the dominant player, there is a regional party and Muslims have been voting for that regional party for a very large number, but these Muslim voters are not voting because of any love for that regional party. They have got the signal that there is a chance for their entry into those localities where Muslims are in sizable number, because there is a possibility that Muslims in many constituencies would be looking forward to an alternative. So they would try their luck. I think they are going to be successful, relatively more successful now compared to the past when they try to put up candidates in, say, Western UP or in some other parts of the UP. They did contest, they did put up candidates in the previous 2 assembly elections in UP, but they are not successful. I think they are going to try their luck in 2022 in UP, and they would be successful in some constituencies like they have done in Bihar.
My response is quick, Asim. I find in Bihar, these 2 developments, interlinked. As I have spoken about, a long tradition of left politics in Bihar that will continue. And since, I have also indicated and spoken about a fading away of socialist politics in Bihar. So certainly, this way, left will continue to remain, one of the streams of politics in Bihar. And I agree with Sanjay that, left politics of Bihar, it's basically Malay kind of politics. Malay kind of politics, if you look at, flaming field kind of a politics, is very difficult to be replicated elsewhere. So when we look at the structural properties of Indian party system, I would consider, a more regionalized, continuation of left in Bihar. And I agree that perhaps we don't look at Bihar in terms of the regional distinctions. North Bihar, Central Bihar, you know, so and that way left politics will be there, you know, and continue to inform at least, you know, future coalitional arrangements in politics in Bihar. So that way they will remain significant as well. I'm giving them that, you know, credit to them because there is a long historical tradition. And also you have to look at, you know, who they are mobilizing. They are mobilizing Dalit voters, I think. Many political, you know, observers have perhaps ignored the fact that the Bihar Naxal movement was largely manifestation, you know, of Dalit politics. You know, that is why BSP hasn't spread and become a strong political party, you know, as an identity politics or politics of recognition. Secondly, coming back to, you know, Ovasi party, I find there is an opening for what Rudolph called confessional politics in Bihar. And this is also responding to, you know, gradual strengthening of majoritarian politics in Bihar. As majoritarian politics become dominant, I'm sure that in the future to come, the confessional politics will also occupy some significant space. So that's not rule it out. And perhaps it will spill over to other parts of the country with the spread and the dominance of the BJP as a national dominating political.
So there is another question with regards to why education fails to be a priority during elections in Bihar. And secondly, do you think that now with the coming in of power, Nitish is going to work towards employment? And do you see that happening in Bihar now? The unemployment issue in Bihar.
Sanjay, I'm asking Sanjay. Sanjay, what was the response to the question of education, you know, in the survey, you know? I didn't get it.
Response to the question of education. No, when you talk about when employment becomes a big issue, then it is a byproduct of good education. Education. Yes. So education does not become an issue. Even the students are not raising up the issue of providing good educational opportunity. Because they know that what is the byproduct, what is the final product of good education is employment. So give us employment, whether it is through education or not. So that is why education does not figure into people's mind or even the youth's mind when it comes to election issue. They don't raise the demand of providing good educational opportunities.
And Khushbu, a small memory, you know, from the past, you know, late 70s or early 80s. When the migration started from Bihar, you know, young, you know, people going out for education, JNU. I mean, I'm referring to older JNU brigades, you know. Biharis has always been going out for education, coming back and seeking employment. I agree with Sanjay. It's like, you know,
and
education.
What was education attached to that? There was another question.
Employment. Do you think that Nitish government is going to work towards unemployment, the issues of unemployment now?
On a lighter note, I don't know how many years Nitish is going to be the chief minister.
Yes.
he has his approach. He has always been saying, "Naukri generate karna koi asaan kaam nahi hai, koi jadu ki chhadi nahi hai," which is right. So he would definitely try, but I don't think this is going to be very easy for any government, whether we had a Tejasvi government now or whether we are going to have a Nitish Kumar's government. Not easy.
I think here, you know, the larger issue is that, you know, whether or not Bihar will attract, you know, more private investment, if you look at as a political economist, the size of the market is very limited in Bihar. So where would you create jobs? I mean, other than the government jobs. So I agree with Sanjay, it's a humongous task, you know, it's an almost impossible task. And given the pandemic related contraction of, you know, GDP, I guess, you know, I don't know whether you have received salary or not. I'm not going to comment in public, but it's a really, really tough task. You know.
On that note, how do you think, what is going to be the nature of this coalition? Do you think it's going to be like a BJP dominant coalition? And what effect would it have on the, you know, on the position of the chief minister?
Yes, it is going to be a BJP dominant coalition. What happens to the position of the chief minister? Just wait for Diwali to be over and we'll all get to know what happens.
Kushba, it's a BJP government, and BJP. It's not NDA government.
This is a question that I don't know if it's somebody says that, do you think that the people, the voters have acted responsibly in the Bihar elections of 2020?
Everybody who goes out to vote, he or she thinks that he has voted responsibly. If you aggregate all those responses of the individuals, we get a response that yes, voters have responded responsibly. Who thinks that I have not voted responsibly? So aggregation of everything, of all those responses, actually give us the, at least to me, that voters have voted responsibly. They responded to Tejasvi's appeal.
Yes.
They also considered some of the good work which was done by Nitish Kumar's government. I don't say that Nitish Kumar government has not done anything. There have been remarkable achievement of Nitish Kumar's government in terms of, we have been discussing that, road, bijli, electricity, law and order, etc. So people recognize that, 37% people recognize that, 37% people also recognize the promises which were being made by Tejasvi Yadav. What better intelligence you can see among the voters of Bihar? It's an absolutely intelligent vote.
Kushba, I absolutely agree with Sanjay ji. I mean, like, Bihari voters have really confirmed the trend in Indian politics of, you know, what we call wise and mature voting. You know? And this is where, you know, Bihar may be very poor and a supplier of labor elsewhere, but it is here every Bihari voter. And I agree completely and, you know, in agreement that the success and the strike rate of, you know, Tejasvi Yadav and BJP, you know, confirms that trend. You know, Nitish Kumar, you know, if you look at, you know, what I call second generation of governance, you know, it is Nitish who created this aspiration for second generation governance. Let us not, you know, take away the credit that he deserves. His time is perhaps over. His politics has become dated, you know, in some sense, and he himself has created that. In that way, you know, on a lighter note, you know, it's good that Nitish Kumar doesn't continue like Jyoti Babu, you know, and then decimate completely a kind of a politics and hand over, you know, the state to a different kind of politics. Sanjay ji, I compare to you.
हाँ नहीं आप आपने तो मेरे बाद में बोला इसीलिए डिट्टो एकदम सही है
नहीं नहीं नहीं
सही है साढ़े चार
बाद और आगे की बात और आगे की बात नहीं कह रहा हूँ मैं ये कह रहा हूँ कि लेकिन संजय जी मैंने पहले भी कहा है और कुछ आज भी कहता हूँ कि बिहार के लिए इन हिंदी आई एम टॉकिंग नाउ बिकॉज यू नो इट्स वेरी बिहार की जमीन इफ यू लुक एट यू नो हिस्टोरिकली यू नो इस जमीन इस मिट्टी में कभी आलोक धनवा ने कहा था कि अभी भी इस मिट्टी में बारूद की खुशबू होती है I think many Biharis today, you know, for us, you know, the ballot is, you know, that khushbu of barood. And isliye bar bar main kehta hu, kisi ko kahin bhi jata hu, ki dekhiye bhai, BJP has won, NDA has won. Hamari kya dua hogi unke liye as a political scientist or as a shayad? Meri dua yahi hai, you know, Sanjay ji and others, you know. Meri khwahish hai ki aangan mein na deewar uthe. Meri khwahish hai ki aangan mein na deewar uthe. मेरे भाई मेरे हिस्से की जमी तू रख ले सेव बिहार यू नो दैट्स इंपॉर्टेंट यू नो दैट्स द कैरेक्टर
ठीक है विद दिस ब्यूटीफुल पोएट्री वर्सेस इट्स 4:30 सो वील जस्ट ट्राई टू वाइंड दिस सेशन इफ देयर नो प्रेसिंग क्वेश्चंस एनीबॉडी हु इज विल नॉट टेक द इवनिंग ब्रेकफास्ट बिफोर आस्किंग द क्वेश्चन देन गो अहेड अदरवाइज वी मे बी अलाउड टू क्लोज द सेशन So my take, if I understand, Ashwani ji, there is a Professor Lina Abraham wants to know the English translation of your poetry.
I would say that link to read my latter notes too.
Okay.
I'm really grateful. I'm really grateful.
Okay. So I think what it was an immensely enriching experience for all of us, and. One of the very critical things which I will take away that it is not the end of the caste politics. It is something, the language of politics has changed. It has been recasted in a different versus, but the vote banks remains the same. By and large, this is a story which I have understood where Sanjay ji emphatically pointed out that youth as a category may have emerged, but it has not translated as a universalism, as a phenomenon which is universal. So it is again recast it in a different, Lalu had a different language to mobilize and Tejaswini has a different language to mobilize. But more important, what is it that we see that there are two alternative, there's a vacuum which is emerging and that's where OIC and left both have emerged. Ashwani ji says that traditional left is always a traditionally been strong in Bihar. And that's particularly true, particularly the ML politics, which is there and which is, has been for long. Even the CPI politics has been for long. But there is a certain kind of a vacuum. If these politics re-emerges, there's a certain vacuum which the traditional political parties are not able to fulfill. And one of the most important distinction which one could think of is that the youth and the gender, that was, at least I was not aware of that, that young women voted differently and the young men voted differently. And their reason for voting was the welfare scheme, which is obvious to us at now. That was absolutely enriching. And I really enjoyed the way Ashwini ji was able to draw substantive theoretical implications of many of the practical implications which we have seen just now in the Bihar polity. And thank you so much for coming here. And I'm really grateful to all of you, to the students, to the perspective team, to the Khushbu who has managed this session excellently well, has done the background work, the perspective. There's a whole group of students who, I think there's a question which Padma wants to ask. Professor Padma will ask her. Quick question before we close the session. Professor Padma will ask her. Anyway, so okay.
Hello, no, Asim, I did not. I did not want to ask any question. Was some indication had come?
Yeah, have raised your hand.
No. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much again, Ashwani ji, Sanjay ji, for really making the our students understand the nuances of Bihar politics. Most of them come from South India. And other states, they're not very well versed in the politics of Bihar. So thank you so much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.